Quest presents an unabridged recording of The Last Night by Griff Hosker, narrated by Marston York. Prologue. Weedon, January 1428. I had failed Sir William Strongstaff. He had entrusted me with the protection of the Queen of England and her son. I had been unable to do anything about the Queen, for she took up with a Welshman, Owen Meredith Tudor, and she fled the court. She abandoned her son, King Henry VI, in Windsor, leaving me to be his bodyguard. I had little opportunity to do that which I had promised Sir William, for until he was 7, I could not even think of making him a warrior. And when, shortly after the Queen had gone, the Earl of Warwick, Richard de Beauchamp, brought John Somerset to be his teacher, I was summarily dismissed. It was decided that the young Henry did not need a knight who was not noble-born to be the one who shaped him. The nobles had overridden Sir William's and King Henry V's wishes. But it was done with a smile, an annuity, and a manner in Normandy did not change the fact that I would not be able to mould the child king, King Henry, into a warrior. Perhaps that was the reason he proved to be such a disappointment. Or maybe it is I who was the failure. Lady Eleanor only outlived her husband by 6 months. She was happy when she died, for she would be with her beloved William Strongstaff. Along with her family, we buried her next to him, and I paid for the stone effigy which covered the grave. I felt that I owed them both. To ensure that I did not attempt to communicate with the young king, I was asked to raise a company and join the English army in Normandy. The commander was the Earl of Salisbury, who had been charged to raise 450 men-at-arms and 2,200 archers. It was easier leaving Weedon than I had expected. There were too many memories there, and each time I saw Sir William's sword and poleaxe, they were a reminder that I had failed him. I could not get it out of my head that the only reason I had not been guarding his back at Valnoy was that I had been watching an infant. Had I been at that battle, then who knows, I might have saved his life or died in his place. Had he lived, then the nobles would not have dared to ignore his advice. Ralph had finally joined James. His wounds had gradually taken him. But before he died, he appointed a reeve for me. At the time, I was still doing my duty for a queen who was forever sneaking off to be with her lover and watching a child who did not like to play rough. Walter was a good man. He was Will Straightshaft's son. And whilst that archer, like so many of those who had followed Sir William, was dead, his son still lived in the manor. Born with a weaker left arm, he could never be an archer, but he loved the manor and, recently married, was the perfect man to watch over it whilst I was away. When we had been dismissed from Windsor, I returned to Weedon with Jack, my squire, knowing that we might not return to England for some time. His mother and father were not getting any younger, and so Jack stayed with Alan of the Woods while I put the matters of the manor in order. The day before we were due to leave, Jack had returned to help me pack. And on our last evening, I sat with Walter and Jack before a fire in the room that still felt as though Lady Eleanor was seated in the chair which still nestled next to it. Walter knew the manor and the accounts better than any.
"You are a rich man, Sir Michael. Lady Eleanor knew how to run a farm, and this one makes more profit than most of the other manors Sir William owned."
I nodded. I felt honoured that I was left this by Sir William. Daventry might be bigger and the other manors more prestigious, but this was the first home I knew.
"And do I send the profits to you?"
Shaking my head, I said, "Keep them guarded here in chests. Use the treasure room Lady Eleanor built." I smiled, a mark of the trust she felt that she only told those closest to her of its position. Walter smiled.
"And now that you have told me there are only the three of us, 'tis a great responsibility."
"You will manage." I stared into the flickering fire, wondering what else I had to tell him. The war in France might last for years, and who knew when I might return. I will try to write to you when I can, but it is more likely that either Sir Thomas or Sir Henry will hear of my death, should that happen, or the victories or defeats. The two knights were Sir William's sons. It had been many years since they had gone to war, and they now paid scutage for others to do their duty. They were both good men, but they were not their father. He had been, in my view, unique. His background, the result of a union between a drunken man-at-arms and a camp follower, moulded a man who was chosen to guard a king and then to lead armies in battle. I doubted that I would ever see his like. Jack was a practical squire. I do not think he had enjoyed being at court, and serving as the squire of a knight who would go to war was more his style.
"Horses, Sir Michael. Do we take them or buy them?"
There had been a time when there would have been an easy answer, but my last war horse was still somewhere in France. When I had left France to guard the Queen and her infant son, I had ridden a hackney. As a bodyguard, I had not needed a war horse. "We will wait until we reach France. The voyage rarely does them any good."
"And the men, Sir Michael?"
"Time was that we could simply have taken the men from the manor, but now..." Jack was right. This was a little late for such discussions, but the command had been given to me, and with all the necessary work to leave the manor secure, the fact that I did not have enough men was a problem I would have to deal with quickly, and not here in Weedon. After Agincourt, and that had been 13 years earlier, the warriors who had fought for Sir William had gradually left war behind them, and fewer had gone to war. Ralph and James had been the only ones at Valnoy along with Sir Rufus. "I have been told to raise a company of 10 mounted archers and 10 men-at-arms at my expense. The Earl of Warwick has told me that the manor of Herouville in Normandy will more than compensate. But you are right, we need to find them soon before we join Sir John Talbot."
"He was at Verneuil, was he not, Sir Michael?"
"Aye, and achieved great honour. I am confident that he will be a good commander."
"But not a Sir William Strongstaff?"
I shook my head. "No, Jack. And there will never be the like again." Chapter 1. Rouen, 1428. I had been both lucky and surprised when I managed to hire 6 mounted archers and 5 men-at-arms before we had even left Weedon. They came because Sir William's sons, hearing that I needed to hire men, had spread the word, and the 11 came because they either remembered me or, in most cases, Sir William. The fact that we had left in January when there was little other work helped, and some men get maudlin at Christmas, especially if they do not have wives and families. The men who came were 11 such. By the time we reached Southampton, and while Jack negotiated a passage, I found another 4 archers and 4 men-at-arms. That left me with one place to fill, and I gambled that I would find one in Normandy. Often men-at-arms fell out with their lord and left them. We picked men up all the way from Weedon, through England, across the Channel, and down through France. The journey took almost 3 weeks, and in that time Jack and I heard the stories of the men I now led. That gave me an insight into them, and told me what I might expect when we went into battle. That was the only time you really got to know a man, but their stories told me much. The men-at-arms were Geoffrey of Yarpole, who had fought on the Welsh marches, as had the warrior who came with him, David of Denby. Both men knew Thomas of Chester, another man-at-arms, from the Welsh Wars, and soon the 3 became close, sharing a hovel and food. Richard Richardson and Humphrey of Oxford had both served Sir William's son, Sir Thomas, and were as close to local Weedon men as we found. Robert Fanshawe and William of Hereford had both served the Earl of Gloucester in the south of Wales. They were both sick of hunting Welsh bandits who had the skill to hurt, and yet when they were captured yielded little in the way of treasure. They both wished to fight in France where the rewards were greater. Ralph and James had taught me that such men are not to be disparaged for their mercenary attitude. Great lords and nobles were exactly the same, but they won greater rewards, often for less effort. Edward Pollax and John Marston both joined at Southampton. They had heard of the Earl of Salisbury's need for men, and it was pure luck that they joined me. The archers had more varied backgrounds. Will Greenhose and Harry Bodkin Blade both came with my two men-at-arms, David of Denby and Geoffrey, having fought with them on the marches. Mark the Bowyer and John the Fletcher were both good archers, but had never fought abroad. They had served the Earl of Chester and came with Thomas of Chester. Dick of Tarpley and Roger Bylinge were also Cheshire archers who had worked for many different lords. The two seemed restless souls, but they were good friends. Robbie Redfletch was a larger-than-life character. To hear him speak, he had fought in every major battle on the Scottish border. As he was the only archer from that area, we had no means to corroborate his story, but he took the jibes and banter from the others in his stride. He seemed arrogant and full of himself, but he knew how to pull a longbow. Cedric the Pig was the son of a pig farmer. A good archer, he had not been to war, but he had fallen out with his father after his mother died, and his father remarried a younger woman. This would be his first campaign, and I was glad that he fell in with Nicholas Warbag, whom we discovered at Southampton. He had fought at Vernoy and remembered Sir William well. He knew the land, and as we later discovered, was a master when it came to scouting. Edgar Whitestreak was the oldest warrior and the least sociable. It was hard to find out anything about him. All that we learned was that the white streak was the result of a wound he had suffered as a young man. He had seen almost 40 summers, and had there been an alternative, then I might have taken it, for he appeared solitary, and I did not like such men. My livery was simple enough. I had a blue background and the staff of Strongstaff upon it. We would, however, be fighting for King Henry and England. As such, we wore the even simpler English livery of a red cross. My archers wore the padded gambeson, while the men-at-arms the simple jupon. The men-at-arms wore the plate and mail they had acquired over the years. No two looked identical, and the weapons they brought also reflected their personal choice. The archers had helmets and coifs, but once again they were unique to each archer. I did not mind. It was when we were waiting for the ship that Jack came to me, smiling. "What has amused you?"
"Not amused, Sir Michael, but pleased. The men have decided that they wish to be identified as the men of the Strongstaff. They are sewing the badge to their breasts."
I was touched by the gesture, which I knew was not for me, but for England's hero, Sir William. It was the first sign that they were becoming one company. Once we landed, then I needed to buy horses for my men. The money I laid out would be taken from the pay of the men, but the horses would become theirs. The hackneys for the archers were not expensive, but the coursers were. As soon as the Earl of Salisbury had announced the campaign, then prices had risen. It was fortunate that I was rich, although to me money meant little. What did surprise me was that despite my youth, all seemed happy to take orders. That included the doer, Edgar Whitestreak. The fact that I had been chosen as the bodyguard for the Queen and the young King Henry seemed to impress them, even though I had not had any work to do. I still owed much to Sir William. I had a reputation that I had partly inherited from him, and I had the fortune he had left me. I owed it to him to make my company the best in the army. We bought as quickly as we could, for more men were arriving daily. I did not meet the Earl of Salisbury for a few days, but I did meet Sir John Talbot, who landed just 2 days after we did. He had been at Vernoy, and whilst not the complete leader when I first met him, was the closest I had seen to compare with Sir William, and I got on with him immediately. The army was camped outside the city, and each day more and more men joined us. I was surprised when he sought me out. Although he had seen 40 summers, it felt like talking to someone my age. His bright eyes and enthusiastic smile made me warm to him immediately. with Lady Eleanor, Sir William, Ralph, and James all dead, I felt like an orphan, and to be greeted like that endeared him to me.
"I have heard much about you, Michael of Weedon. The Earl of Warwick speaks highly of you."
Not so high, of course, that he would leave the future king in my charge. Perhaps Sir John was one of those men who could read your thoughts, for he lowered his voice as he said,
"The Earl has a vision for England. King Henry was a warrior king. He almost died many times. It may be that the Earl thinks we need a king who is less of a warrior and more of a planner like his grandfather."
I said stiffly, "It is not my place to comment, my lord." He laughed.
"And now you are to serve with me."
I looked at him in surprise.
"The Earl of Salisbury commands the army, but I am given part of it to do as I will. I have plans and ideas. As yet, some of them are a little unformed, and I would use you to try them out."
"Me, my lord?"
"Aye. You are untainted by the views of any other lord, and I know that Sir William was a warrior who was receptive to new ideas. Come, let us go into the city and walk the walls of William the Conqueror's castle."
He turned to our squires.
"We shall not need you to. Enjoy the afternoon."
He waited until we were on the great walls of the city before he spoke.
"The death of King Henry was a great blow. His brother, the Duke of Bedford, is a good leader and, God willing, will continue to reconquer France. I would have the men I lead fight alongside other commands."
He stared off into the distance.
"I am but recently arrived, Sir Michael, and I do not yet know the men I will lead. Some may be the leaders I hope them to be, but there are some who will fail, and worse, there may be others who are traitors or work for the French."
He shrugged.
"Some men may even just plan and plot to better themselves and care not for the standard that they follow. The Burgundians are our allies once more, but we do not yet know if the alliance will last. Thanks to your position with the young king these last years, I know you are untainted by such things, and the Earl of Warwick told me that you were more than disappointed when your charge was taken away. You, I can trust. Others, I will discover more over the next few days. You command 20 men. I would have you command other, smaller lances, for that way the chain of command is shorter. I would tell you and the other commanders, and then the orders would be passed on to your men. In all, you would command 30 men. Your archers would be the only such warriors in your command. When I have better knowledge, you will have more men to command. I lead 500 men for the Earl of Salisbury."
"Am I ready?" We paused to look down at the huge moat fed by the river which lay at the bottom of the wall.
"Sir William believed so, else why would he put the king in your charge? I have spoken to those who fought alongside you, and they all agree that you are a natural leader. When King Henry knighted you, then he recognized it too. Forget that you are young. I know many greybeards I would not let command an empty baggage train. Age is no measure of ability." "What do you think of the idea?"
"I think it is a sound one, my lord, and it was the way that Sir William worked. My men are new to me, but I am confident that we will soon find a good way of working. I am still one man short." He waved an airy hand.
"No matter, you have horses?"
I nodded.
"I've brought my own, but they will take some days to become accustomed to land. I would have you take your men, and those of Sir Gilles de Bayeux and Sir Jean de Mont, to discover the strength of our enemies. Although they are Norman, they are young and keen to fight the French. Both knights know the Seine, and I would have you become familiar with it."
"Will you need us to wear your livery, my lord?" Sir John's men wore the badge of the hunting dog, the Talbot, on their right breasts. He shook his head.
"My familiar and the men I brought shall, but your men are still yours."
We had reached the main gate again and we descended. Sir John had given me more time than a lowly knight such as myself might have expected, and I nodded when we stepped from the stairs.
"I am honoured by your trust,
and I will seek to do all that I can. What is it that I am to do?
The land to the south is largely loyal to King Henry. Paris, he shrugged, is like London, a nest of vipers. The Duke of Bedford and his men hold the city, but it is not ours. There are some places which have changed sides and now support the Armagnac party and Orléans.
I stopped. I thought that the Duke of Orléans was still a prisoner in England, and as such his city is to be untouched. Sir John smiled.
You have a quick mind. I like that. You are right, and the Duke of Bedford has no intention of taking Orléans. But it is a hotbed of treachery, and it is there that the plots are hatched. By taking the land between Orléans and Paris, we minimise the threat. All that I need you to do is to ride the land for a few days to allow me to spend time with my other leaders, as I have with you. Come this evening to the house I use on the Rue Romaine. There you can meet Sir Gilles de Bayeux and Sir Jean de Mont. The Earl of Warwick will also come. He is to lead the campaign with the Earl of Salisbury. We are blessed to be led by great commanders.
I headed back through the busy streets and morning markets, the numbers swollen by more newly arrived soldiers buying what they had forgotten to bring. I wondered at my new responsibility. I was still not sure of my men. I had spoken to them on the ship and I knew their stories, but as Rafe and James had drilled into me, you never knew a man truly until you had fought alongside each other. Sir William had been brought up in companies where he knew the men intimately, and his men had been of the same ilk. I knew Jack well, and that was all. The rest seemed like good fellows and stout warriors, but war would show me their true mettle. The enormity of what I had to do hit me. I was also keenly aware that I had to be discreet with my tongue. Sir John had been open with me, but I could not be as open with my men until I came to know them. Jack would have to be my confidant. He had been with me long enough that I could speak to him like a brother. Once I had spoken to him, then I would give a version of our task to the others. I saw my archers at the butts which had been set up. They were competing against other archers. I knew that there would be wages, that was in the nature of the men. My men-at-arms were watching and, no doubt, gambling. As Jack was not yet back, I joined them. They did not leap to their feet, for I had soon rid them of the habit. They showed me respect, but I did not want them leaping around like men with St. Vitus dance. Geoffrey and David, as close friends, were seated on a log together, and Geoffrey of Yarpole nodded towards Roger Bylinge. "Sir Michael, there is your best archer. Roger may not be the biggest man, but he has the accuracy. David and I have won 10 shillings already for men misjudged him." David shook his head.
"Sadly, the others know this, and we will not make as much from now on."
I nodded towards Robbie Redfletch.
"And Robbie?"
David stroked his chin.
"I thought he might bear blue hard, but despite his boasting of his deeds, he is a good archer. The trouble is that others do not bet against him. He has not made as much coin yet."
I saw that Edgar Whitestreak was, as usual, seated alone. He had a dagger and was carving a piece of yew. No doubt he would be carving a bow.
"And Edgar?"
Geoffrey shook his head.
"He seems a good archer, my lord, but he does not seem to like to compete. He does just enough at the butts to keep his eye in, and then he whittles. He is a solitary man, lord, and there is a tail beneath that craggy face, but none can discover it."
I nodded. The two stood, and Geoffrey asked somewhat diffidently,
"It is a large army, my lord. When do we go to war?"
The other men-at-arms, who had appeared not to be listening, suddenly stiffened as their ears heard Geoffrey's words. I smiled.
"We will be riding abroad in the next few days. Make the most of the gambling while you can."
The news was greeted with smiles, and I knew that the practicing archers would soon know. I wandered over to Edgar. He nodded and murmured,
"Afternoon, my lord."
I decided to speak about archery in the hope of eliciting more about my archer. If we were to scout with just 10 archers, then I needed to know that I could rely on them.
Something told me that Edgar was a reliable archer, but I had to be sure. Why did you join my company, Edgar? You look to be of an age where you could enjoy a family and the peace of England.
You wish me to leave, my lord?
I shook my head. No, but you must see that you sit alone, and whilst I know you have the skill, you must understand that a company should be as one. He nodded and returned to his whittling. I do not think it was rudeness, but just a way of allowing him to think.
What you say is right, my lord. I fought in a company, first at Agincourt and then at Verneuil. I saw Sir William fight and die. It was one reason I joined you, but in that battle I lost all of my tent brothers and I was wounded in the side. It took a year for me to recover. I do not risk a friendship for fear of losing it.
I understood that, and I opened up a little to him. I was at Agincourt. He looked in surprise at me.
You must have been but a boy.
I laughed. Aye, Edgar. 14 summers. I lost one lord at Harfleur and a second, Davy Gam, at Agincourt. I returned to England with my company. Our sergeant was also called Edgar. Is that not strange? He gave a rare smile.
Aye, my lord, it is.
We were ambushed in England on the Great Road as we headed home. I was the only survivor and barely lived. Sir William had me tended to and I recovered. I returned with him as a squire to Agincourt, where we had vengeance for another squire murdered by the French at Agincourt. He was silent and I saw him gather himself to speak.
That is the other reason I follow your banner, for Sir William avenged my son Edward. He was with the boys and squires and he was slain. He was but 11 years old. When I returned to England and broke the news to my wife, she died of a broken heart.
I am sorry. He shook his head.
My lord, you have lost more than I have, for you lost one family, and then Sir William. I see another reason to follow your banner. You helped to avenge my son.
I did little enough.
You did more than me. You've also shown me that a man can make a new start. I came here for vengeance. I would kill as many Frenchmen as I can. But perhaps I can help these archers survive.
He smiled.
You have good lads here, but they need an old, wiser head, do they not?
Are you willing to be my vintner?
If you will have a miserable old man, then I, my lord.
Good. What do you make of the archers?
You have been lucky, my lord, or perhaps God favours you. They are all good archers and, I think, good men.
He pointed to Robbie Redfletch, who was laughing loudly.
I thought him a popinjay, a cockerel who crowed without good reason, but he is one of the best archers you have. He just needs to curb his crowing.
Perhaps he does it as a defence, Edgar.
Defence, my lord?
Like your doerness, he may be afraid of letting men come close in case he loses them. He nodded as he considered my words.
Wisdom beyond your years, my lord. You could well be right. Roger is the best archer. He is calm and reliable, at least at the butts. Until you've seen a man facing horsemen charging him, then you do not truly know.
He stood and sheathed his knife.
You have given me a task, my lord, and I purpose to my life once more. I will still be the miserable old codger to the men, but you will know that I am smiling inside.
And so I made my first commander. It was a small thing, but it helped both Edgar and my archers. After I told them all that evening, they became as one and even more reliable than my men-at-arms. As soon as Jack returned, I told him our task and of my appointment. Tonight, Jack, we begin our work, and I hope that Sir William, Rafe, and James approve. I gathered my men around me before our campfire. We were still eating well, although I knew that would not last, and the food that they would eat that night was cooking away, filling the air with enticing aromas. Tomorrow will be our last day of ease, for we ride south to scout out the enemy. We will be riding with Normans who know the land, but I want my archers as the scouts who sniff out the enemy. Surprisingly, it was Edgar who spoke.
Then that would be Nicholas Warbag, my lord. He fought at Verneuil too, and he can find the French as well as any man I have known.
Nicholas looked in surprise.
I did not think you remember me, Edgar.
He sniffed and said, looking at Robbie, Just because I do not crow about all that I have done does not make me simple. I remember you.
John Marston put his hand up.
And I have ridden the same, my lord. I am no scout, but my French is good and I know their defences.
The parts of my command were becoming whole. Then the task will not be as hard as I expected. Jack and I dressed and left for the house of Sir John Talbot. I left Edgar in command and none argued about it. It was another step along the road to leadership. The house which Sir John had been loaned was a large one, and as he was a rich man, his wife was a Neville, he had plenty of servants, fine food, and an excellent cellar. Jack and I felt like poor relations as we were ushered into the small dining hall. As well as the two knights I would be leading, there were six of Sir John's household knights: Sir Eustace Wellfield, Sir William Labier, Sir Thomas Kiriel, Sir Hugh Chalmers, Sir Richard Whiteley, and Sir Thomas Scales. Sir Gilles de Bayeux and Sir Jean de Mont were both Normans, but their English was good. I was aware that as a poor boy from Kildale in North Yorkshire, I was lucky that I could speak a form of English that others could understand. Lady Eleanor and Sir William had begun to teach me both Norman and French, but it was the Queen who had managed to make my accent slightly less unbearable, and my linguistic skills now enabled me to understand others. What it did not do, however, was allow me to infer meaning from the words they used. Sir William had used that skill well. He had done everything well. Thanks to my meeting with my men, I was the last to arrive, and the others were all seated and waiting for me. Jack wisely scurried off to help the other squires to serve, and I bowed and apologised. Sir John was magnanimous.
Do not give it another thought, dear boy. We have managed to start on another jug of wine, and you have much catching up to do. Let me introduce you.
I confess I paid more attention to the two knights I would be leading than the other men. They were almost of an age with me, but they dressed better. I could afford to dress better, but it had not seemed important before. As a bodyguard to the king and his mother, I was more used to wearing functional clothes which would allow me to do my duty effectively. Fine houppelande, hose and richly decorated belts, expensive shoes, not to mention rings, were not even part of my thought process. I saw the two Normans exchange a look when I spoke to them. My English was not as good as theirs, and it was their second language. I also looked young to them. Sir John showed me then that he had a good sense of mood. He said casually,
Did you know, gentlemen, that Sir Michael here was with Sir William when he exacted vengeance on those murderers of boys after Agincourt?
He let that sink in and added, He was also one of the last knights to be knighted by King Henry.
I know that we are lucky he is here to lead one of my columns. I am sure that you two will learn much from him.
I hid my smile as their expressions changed. Sir John smiled.
Let us eat, and then I can explain my strategy to you. I have already done Sir Michael the courtesy of giving him an insight into the way we shall win back France for young King Henry and his uncle, the Duke of Bedford.
He spoke smoothly about what he and the Earl of Salisbury intended. He laid out the targets, and it was clear that once we had secured the towns taken by the French, we would move south to take the strongholds west of Orléans. The two Normans were rapt as they listened. The six household knights had heard it all before. When he had finished, we were ready to eat the sweet delicacies his cooks had prepared.
So, my friends, what do you think? You can see why I have chosen you two to be in Sir Michael's company, for your lands lie to the north of the Loire. Sir Gilles, you are from Le Mans, I believe, and Sir John, your demesne, is at Lorges.
They both nodded.
Sir John said,
We have both campaigned along the Seine, and I think we can offer Sir Michael the support he needs. Our men are well mounted, and we are eager to serve the Duke of Bedford.
Good. When can you leave?
If we had to, then I could leave at dawn, but I was interested in what the two knights said.
Sir Gilles shrugged. It matters not to me.
He turned to me.
Sir Michael, do we need to take servants?
I laughed. Sir William taught me to take as few men as possible who were not warriors when you raided. This amounts to a small chevauchee. We will take tents if you wish, but your men-at-arms shall lead the animals which carry them. We are happy to use hovels. From here to Chartres is 60 or 70 miles. It might mean 4 nights in the open, but it is summer. Sir Gilles frowned and then nodded.
Sir Jean said, I cannot leave until noon.
We all looked at him and he smiled.
Nothing sinister, but if we are to ride 130 miles, then I need 2 horses to be reshoed.
That was disappointing. Admittedly, we had just acquired our horses, but a good knight or man-at-arms ensured his horse was ready at all times. We had 6 spares we would leave in Rouen.
Sir John said, It cannot be helped, then. You leave at noon. I shall ride with you for the first 10 miles just to get a feel for the land, you understand? My horse has acclimatized quicker than I had expected. You will command, Sir Michael, and I will enjoy the ride. We will meet at the northern edge of the bridge over the Seine.
A shadow of doubt came into my mind. Did Sir John not trust me? Chapter 2. In light of the horse issue raised by Sir John, I had 2 of my spares readied to come with us. That was not a great problem, as we would have needed one in any case for the spare arrows. I made a point of discussing the formation of the archers with Edgar. It was not just to show the men I trusted him. I genuinely needed the advice of the old campaigner. I had never really led before, and whilst others thought I could do it, I was still nervous inside. Edgar nodded.
Nicholas is an obvious choice as scout, my lord, and I think that it would do Robbie Redfletch good to ride with him. Nicholas is quieter, and he will not allow Robbie to chatter on like a magpie. If he was silent more than he is at present, he would become more useful. I would ride at the rear with Dick and Roger. Both are sound men and get on. The others I would place close to you and Sir John. If they ride 40 paces ahead, then you and Sir John can talk and you will be protected.
I liked the idea. Nodding, I said, But I will send Nicholas and Robbie to scout soon after dawn. I would prefer we all left at dawn, but as we have to wait for Sir John and his men, let us use that time well. Nicholas can scout out 10 miles of the road and await us. We will not be crossing the bridge, but following the Seine. They can await us at the Pont L'Arche, where we do cross the Seine. Edgar gave a rare chuckle.
I see now why you lead, my lord. You are careful. This is not the land to be reckless in. I trust no Frenchman, and that includes Normans.
They are our allies.
If they speak anything other than English, then they are untrustworthy.
Edgar had strong views, and in all the time I knew him, I never saw his convictions waver. He was with me when we gave the 2 scouts their clear instructions. For once, Robbie seemed serious. This would be a good thing for him. We were at the rendezvous early. I was leading. I had a banner, but this did not seem the time to flaunt it. Jack had better things to occupy his hands than carrying the standard. We did not need it. Sir John and Sir Gilles both arrived not long after I did, and we awaited Sir John. I told Sir John what I had done, and he nodded his approval. He, his knights, and their squires added 14 to our number, and that meant we were a formidable force. I wondered if he had planned on coming along with us when we had first spoken on the city walls. I felt the eyes of his household knights upon me, but Sir John just chatted easily with me. We discussed my men and their backgrounds. Sir Jean arrived 10 minutes after the bell in the cathedral had sounded noon. His horse was lathered, showing he had ridden hard. I was about to reprimand Sir Jean, but Sir John beat me to it.
Sir Jean, I would have my knights punctual. We are already tardy in our departure, and that is down to you. When Sir Michael returns from this quest, I will ask him if the rest of your performance is as poor as the start has been. I intend my men to be the best in the whole army."
The young knight seemed contrite.
"I am sorry, my lord, the shoeing took longer than we expected. To make up for it, I beg you to allow me and my men to be the van."
I asserted my authority. "There is no need, Sir John. My archers are the scouts. We have wasted enough time. Will Greenhorse, lead them off." The archers were keen to impress both the Normans and Sir John. They must have had a prearranged signal, for the five of them suddenly dug their heels in their horses' flanks and took off smartly. As we followed, Sir John said, "That was well done, and considering the short time you have had these men, speaks well of you." I knew this was Edgar's doing. I was glad I had spoken to him, and I wondered at what secrets lay beneath the skin of my other men. The road we used ran due south for 8 miles, and then a loop took the river west, and we would cross it at Pont L'Arche. Sir John studied the land as we rode south. This was, in theory, friendly land, but who knew if the Dauphinists might launch a sudden attack? Sir William had been the same. He had viewed every piece of ground as a potential battlefield or place of ambush. There were many villages and farms, and it was neither open nor wooded country. It was farmed and occupied. We took it steadily, for Sir John and his knights would return to Rouen when we reached Louvière. He would then head north and west to cross the Seine at Elbeuf, where he wished to examine the defences of that city. When we stopped to water our horses in the villages through which we passed, he spoke with the locals. Sir Gilles remained at the rear with the baggage, and I wondered at the need for the two Normans. Neither seemed to know the country through which we passed, and they had not offered any advice or information. Sir Jean had offered to scout, and that was the limit of their help. We crossed the river, and I looked for my scouts. They were supposed to meet us there. I frowned. This was not a good sign. Had they gone off somewhere or found an inn? I realized that I was misjudging them. Sir John noticed my frown and said quietly, "Is there a problem, Sir Michael?" I decided honesty was the best policy. "I sent 2 scouts down this road this morning. They were supposed to await us here." I pointed to the forest which stretched to the south of us. "I wanted to be sure of the road."
"You are cautious, and that is good, especially in one so young."
He gave me a curious look.
"And what now?"
I whistled. I do not think I had ever heard a knight whistle, and Sir John smiled. Mark the Bowyer and John the Fletcher turned. "Have Will and Harry ride ahead and seek Nicholas and Robbie. You three string your bows."
"Aye, my lord."
I turned in the saddle. The household knights and the squires obscured my men-at-arms and archers.
"Jack, have Edgar and the others string their bows. Tell the men-at-arms to be wary."
"Aye, my lord."
I lifted my shield and hung it loosely from my arm. Sir John smiled and emulated me. I dug my heels into my horse's flanks. I should have spent more time getting to know Maurice. I had thought the name a strange one until the man who sold him to us explained that it was highly appropriate. It was jet black and Moorish, and the name meant just that. The knight who had sold him had been a studious man. When I had asked what had happened to him, fearing that he had died and the horse was unlucky, I had been relieved to hear that he had entered holy orders. He had chosen the cross rather than the sword. Today would be a test of Maurice's training. He responded well to the kick, and we headed into the relative gloom of the forest. We had covered barely 100 paces when my 3 archers stopped and unslung their bows. I knew that they could not loose from the back of their horses, but their action told me that there was danger. I drew my own sword and slowed Maurice. The 3 turned and headed back, followed by my other 4 archers. I saw my archer scouts returning. Nicholas reined in next to me.
"My lord, There is an ambush. A mile down the road, there are 50 men awaiting us.
I nodded, and he continued,
20 men at arms, 5 knights, and the rest are crossbowmen. They have chosen a place where the road arises. The knights await on the road while the crossbows and men at arms are before them in the forest eaves. If we reach the knights, then we would have endured 40 paces of bolts and blades.
Did you see a livery?
Shaking his head, he said, red, with something gold upon it, my lord.
You have done well, Nicholas. I turned to Sir John.
You should return to Elbeuf, my lord, while we deal with these Frenchmen.
And take away so many men, are you that confident?
I shook my head.
In truth, no, my lord. I believe we can turn this to our advantage, but I would not risk your life.
That is not your choice to make. What is your plan?
In answer, I shouted, Edgar. As Edgar and my other archers rode up, I said, I will have Edgar take my archers south to the west side of the forest. We will give them time to get into position and then ride down the road. With our shields on the left, we will have some protection from that side, and when Edgar and the archers spring our own trap, we will charge those on our left.
Sir John beamed.
A sound plan.
My vintner reined in.
Yes, my lord?
Edgar, there is an ambush ahead. Take the archers to the west and attack those on that side of the road. We will charge the others.
He nodded.
Aye, my lord.
He turned.
Dick, tie the sumpters here. Take care, my lord.
Of course.
Your men are familiar with you, Sir Michael.
As I learned with Sir William, they will become my familiar, so why not?
Edgar and the archers simply disappeared into the forest. I turned and said, Shields up, and await my command.
Sir Gilles said, This is madness. We should return to Pont-l'Arche and get more men.
If you are afraid, Sir Gilles, then wait here with the sumpters.
He coloured. I am not a coward. Neither am I a fool. But if Sir John rides with you, then so will I.
Sir Jean did not seem concerned about a potential ambush. The household knights moved up alongside Sir John, and my men-at-arms headed forward with me. I led, and a leader leads. This would be the first time we had fought, and I did not intend to let anyone down. Sir William might be looking down from heaven, and I needed his approval.
Jack, behind me.
Hi, Sir Michael.
My squire was now a man, and he was equipped as such. He had a leather brigandine studded with metal, a coif and bassinet helmet, as well as good hide gauntlets, a knight's sword, and a buckler shield. He knew how to fight, and when we had served the king, we had practiced each day. He was as skilled as any. All the times I had fought alongside Sir William came to mind now. I kept us at a steady pace, although any enemy who was vigilant and observant would notice that we had shields upon our arms. I counted on the fact that the crossbowmen would be too busy aiming to notice such things. A crossbow could only be used effectively from a kneeling position or behind a wall. There were no walls in the woods, and the bolts would fly upwards. They would also wish to loose at an upward angle to avoid hitting their companions on the other side of the road. I had my shield angled to accentuate the flight if a bolt hit my shield. I counted the paces along the road. Nicholas would have been accurate, and so when we neared the ambush, I forced myself not to look to the side too much, although an occasional glance would be seen as normal. I caught a flash of brown in the woods, and it was not a natural one. I still could not see the knights, and that meant the ambush would not be sprung until then. Whoever laid the trap would assume that we would charge at 5 solitary knights. David of Denby and Geoffrey of Tarpoly had their horses' heads next to Maurice's rump and would afford some protection. It was Edgar and my archers who preempted the ambush. I saw a flash of colour on the road at the same time as I heard the unmistakable sound of bowstrings and then arrows as they flew through the undergrowth. There were cries from our right. I had 10 archers, and I had to assume that more than half would find a target. There were 12 or 13 crossbows, and I hoped that at least 6 men would be hit. a bolt hit my shield and spiralled up. Other bolts also struck the shields of the rest of the men-at-arms and knights. I waited until I heard the second flight of arrows and then, wheeling Maurice, shouted, "Charge!" We wheeled our horses to our left. We had back plates, but a bolt was capable of penetrating plate armour. For Jack, the risk was even greater. He wore just a brigandine. But we had to take the chance. A crossbow cannot be loaded quickly. The operator has to stand and put his foot to hold down the bow while he pulls back the string. He has a hook on his belt to help him. The ones on our side had loosed one and were now trying to reload quickly as we headed for them. There were men-at-arms with pole weapons waiting for us, and we had none, but we did have surprise and we were mounted. I deemed the crossbows to be more dangerous, and I veered away from the spearman who thrust at my shield and instead slashed down the side of the nearest crossbowman. David of Denby's sword took the spearman, and my sword ripped down the shoulder and arm of the crossbowman, who screamed as I laid him open to the bone. There was the slightest possibility that he might live, but none at all that he would be able to use his right arm. As we had entered the undergrowth, our mounts had naturally chosen the line of least resistance, and that meant we were spread out. We, however, outnumbered the ones facing us, and it was Edgar and my archers who would be in danger, for my scouts had said there were equal numbers on both sides of the road. But I was not worried about archers. They had bows which gave them an advantage until their enemies were within sword range, and that should ensure that they survived. In any case, we had to ensure that Sir John was unharmed. With odds of more than 3-1 against them, the survivors tried to flee, and they failed. In hindsight, we should have taken a prisoner. But Sir Jean and his men were like demons as they laid about with their swords. We had all slowed and were prepared to stop, but they hurtled through the forest, seemingly oblivious to danger. They disappeared after the survivors. Sir John shouted, "The knights, let us close with them." Sir Gilles, my men-at-arms and Sir John's all turned to head for the road. By the time we made the road, Edgar and the archers waved to us. They had either eliminated their enemies or the ambushers had fled. All my men were unharmed. I gave a sweep of my arm to them as I passed. I was telling them that the first choice of loot was theirs. As we looked up the road, I saw that the knights were not there, but we were honour-bound to seek them. By the time Sir Jean and his men had rejoined us, bloodied and besmirched, it was clear that the ambush had failed. Two of Sir Gilles's men had been hurt, and one of those two died of his wounds even as we awaited Sir John. Two squires had also been wounded, but not badly. One of Sir Jean's men had a gashed leg, but we had been lucky. Sir John pulled me to one side where we could speak alone. "That was well done, Sir Michael. But if I seem less than happy, it is because we must have a traitor in Rouen. How else would they know that we were on this road? Perhaps you should return with me." I held out my hand with oats, and Maurice ate them. "If you wish, my lord. But if we do not complete what we set out to do, then we will be attacking blind when the Earl of Salisbury decides to move. I am happy to continue. If anything, I am more eager for my men did all that I asked of them." He nodded his agreement. "Amen to that, Sir Michael. That was a well-planned attack you made, and your men showed that they are worthy of your leadership. I fear Sir Jean had far less control over himself and his men. I regret his selection." "We have another few days yet. Let me see what I can make of him." We parted when the wounds had been attended to. Sir Gilles' wounded man-at-arms returned to Rouen with Sir John, but Sir Jean's man bravely insisted on staying with us. We reached the outskirts of Louvière just before dark, and I sent John Marston to scout it out before we entered. Sir Jean offered to do so, but he had shown me a reckless side I did not like. John returned to tell us that the town was loyal to the Duke of Bedford and that we had shelter for the night. The farmer who loaned us his barn had an accommodating wife who sold us food. We had supplies, but this meant we could see to our weapons and the minor wounds we had incurred. Mail, plate and leather protected us well, but riding through undergrowth meant cuts to faces and horses. We had not bothered with mail or even caparisons for our horses, and they had suffered. Thomas of Chester's horse had suffered a wound from a bolt that had scored a line along his flank. It did not pay to allow such wounds to fester, and, besides, my men were all attached to their horses already. The vinegar we had brought cleansed the wound, and the honey helped to heal it. We ate together, and I spoke to each of my men, as well as the two knights, before we did so. Sir Gilles was bitter about his loss, while Sir Jean seemed keen to pursue the French. I was not happy with either man, for neither had done exactly as I had told them. Sir Jean had not obeyed the horn which recalled him, and Sir Gilles had been slower to attack than I might have wished. Had Sir John not been with us, then it would have been my men who bore the brunt of the fighting. That evening was not a time for conflict. It would have to wait a few days until we returned to Rouen. They both asked me about my plans for the next day. Evreux has a castle and is held by the French. I believe it belongs to the king. Nogent-le-Roi is smaller but guards the crossing of the Eure. We will see if the French defend Nogent and then spy out Evreux. There may be weaknesses there. Sir Jean nodded.
Then we follow the Eure?
We follow the Eure. When I had spoken to them all, I sat with Jack. The farmer's wife and her daughters fetched us a steaming cauldron of food and freshly baked rye bread. I smiled at the looks of disdain from the Normans. They preferred wheat. My men and I were content, for it was the sort of fare we were used to. I was starving, and I was exhausted. Command had taken more out of me than I had expected. Jack sat with me in silence. We had been together since I had been knighted, and he understood my moods better than any. When we had finished, some of the men took to throwing dice. It was not to make money, but to empty the mind. Others took out knives to carve wood. Archers loved to carve. Some just sat and talked, but half of my men just slept. They were the old campaigners who knew that you slept when you could. I stood wearily and shouted, "My men will take the first 6-hour watch. Sir Gilles, have your men take the next 3 hours, and Sir Jean the last." They waved their acknowledgement and I sat down. "David of Denby, organise the men-at-arms to do the first 3 hours. Edgar, the archers, will do the second." I did not say it, but I would stay awake for the whole 6 hours. We were sleeping longer than we needed, but we had fought, and I did not want tired men looking for enemies. My men-at-arms were unhappy that I did this.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.